an ordinary shift for a police officer.
It started out as nothing.
It was innocuous. It was a little crime.
It can quickly take an extraordinary turn.
A simple traffic stop went Stratsfury within 2 minutes.
Speed is 70 miles an hour.
He's outside the petrol station fighting with another male.
A routine case.
You can start off with something and it can turn into something completely different.
Taser, taser! I'm here from you!
Can suddenly spiral into a serious incident.
Then it switched. He locked the door. She knew that something was very, very wrong here.
Stand by, I think we're going to have a decamp. One got out with a baseball bat. There's a ton of cannabis in the car.
They were literally on a rampage.
Sometimes the most minor crimes.
I was looking for a stolen quad bike. Found a lot more.
Can crack major cases.
We were now possibly looking at a serial killer.
Nobody should die that way.
I've never seen anything that horrific.
One of the duties of a pathologist is to determine the cause of death.
Watch on mobile devices or the big screen. All for free. No subscription required. Download Veely now.
Today on Big Little Crimes, a minor accident spirals into a huge case of insurance fraud.
And I then found behind a radiator around about £10,000, the most money I've ever had my hands on.
A routine stop and search uncovers a fearless criminal with a head for heights.
How he was able to do that is mind-blowing, extremely dangerous.
And a taste for violence.
This is a suspect of not only one, but two murders.
But first, an ordinary traffic stop puts an officer right in the line of fire.
I saw the gun, I was very close to it. I knew how much danger I was in.
John Barber's always been a country boy at heart.
I had been brought up in the countryside. I spent time on the farm as a child. I lived in a small village and I liked rural life.
So early in his career, when he got the chance to police the Forest of Bowland in Lancashire, he simply couldn't say no.
You'd wake up in the morning and you'd hear the curlews singing in the fields. You'd watch all the seasons flow in front of your eyes. It was just a wonderful place to live.
And it's not a bad place to work either. John's patch was 77 square miles of countryside.
The beauty about being a rural beat man, you'd get all sorts of inquiries, all sorts of people coming knocking at your door. I think that's one of the exciting things about being a bobby, the fact you can start off with something and it can turn into something completely different.
That's exactly what happened one ordinary day when John was on patrol.
I was in a very remote rural area and I saw this car came up behind me. I noticed that it was a left-hand drive car and it just stood out as being wrong immediately.
John knows every inch of his remote patch and this car just doesn't fit.
So I pulled over and he went past. I was in my own car, I wasn't in a police vehicle marked or anything like that. And as it went past, I made a note of the registration number.
John radios for a vehicle registration check. He starts to follow the car.
It came through that it was a car, should have been a Ford Orion. This was a Ford Granada.
His instinct is right. The car has got false plates and has probably been stolen. And when the driver pulls over, John decides to take a closer look.
His car was parked just over there. So I pulled my car in here alongside. Got out of my car, his window was open, and I spoke to the driver. I just said good morning.
John wants to check the driver's details.
And he pointed this sawn-off shotgun, which was laying on his lap. He just picked it up and pointed it at me.
In a matter of seconds, a very routine vehicle check has taken a very dangerous twist.
I saw the gun, I was very close to it. I knew how much danger I was in.
John's standing at point-blank range. If the driver pulls the trigger, he doesn't stand a chance.
I just backed off like that. Car door opened, so I carried on.
He had then started to make back to the car, and then he drove off.
The armed suspect escapes in his car, leaving John with a split-second decision to make. Fight or take flight.
It's difficult to describe just what I felt. I felt that it was my duty and I wanted to chase after him, but I was also aware of the fact that it was a dangerous situation, but it had to be done. And away I went, as fast as I could.
This is John's patch, and he knows the roads inside out. But he's driving his personal car, he's unarmed, and the nearest backup is 12 miles away. He's on his own.
The nearest town, which Clitheroe, that was 12 miles or more away. I knew there would be no other police officers in the area.
As he gives chase, John makes an emergency call for backup. And over at Clitheroe Police Station, word soon reaches Neil Thompson that there's a gunman on the loose.
Somebody came in the office and said, have you heard this on the radio? No, what's that? John Barber's disturbed him. He's chasing a man with a gun. And that was the first thing. And then, so that's it. It's all hands to the pump then. We all turn out.
But they're half an hour away from John. Still on the tail of the armed suspect.
I was right up behind him. He crashed through the gate of a field.
But I thought, well, I've got to keep watch of him. So I followed him into the field.
As police officers, you click into that mode of protecting one another. So everybody wanted to get here as soon as they could.
Where John is, it's a long way from the police station. A long way.
I got to the top of the brow and I could see a wall and I could see his car, but I couldn't see him. He wasn't sat in a car.
The suspects ditched his car and made a run for it. But John's not giving up yet.
I was a little bit concerned that I might have lost him because it's open countryside here. There's places that he could have hidden quite easily. I stood on top of the wall to try and get a better view and looked across the fields. I couldn't see him, didn't know whether he was laid down anywhere.
Neil thinks he's getting closer. But there's a problem.
You always get that lull, you know, in communications when the radio transmission stops and you think, well, because anything could have happened. First and foremost, is John safe? That's first and foremost. Where's John? Where is he?
He had to be somewhere. I couldn't see him. He wasn't in sight. I was still looking. I looked along the side of the wall to my right-hand side, and I could see him hiding, crouching behind the wall. I shouted at him, said, you're not going to get away. You're surrounded. Give yourself up.
John's now face to face with the suspect again. He tries to bluff his way out of it and convince the armed man he's outnumbered. It's an old trick, but will it work?
I said, I want you to throw your gun down. Again, took two or three times before he did it, but he did it, and then once he'd thrown the gun down. I sort of jumped on him and I said, give me your hands. And he put his hands behind him and I held his hands behind his back.
John's got his man, but it's not over yet. Backup is still on its way, meaning it's just the two of them. John faces an agonizing wait for help.
I got on his back. I could see the gun quite clearly. I could see the cartridges quite clearly. I wanted that help to come. I needed that help to come.
I think it was about 10 minutes from the time I got hold of him before somebody came to my help.
It was a great relief for me. I was elated and to a certain extent emotional as well because of the relief. He was taken away from me and went into a police car.
After a high-speed pursuit and a daring chase on foot, the armed suspect is now in custody, and it's all thanks to John.
Were you angry that he was on your patch?
I was.
Because knowing you as I do, it's like, well, you're not getting away with this. You're on my patch.
Yeah, I was. Yeah. You don't come out here and do things like that.
That's no.
But I didn't want him to get away. I wasn't prepared to let him get away.
But what was he running from? Back at the station, Neil now needs to work out why he was so keen to get away.
We searched the car, obviously. Underneath the compartment where the spare wheel was, I found what I called a compact burgling kit. He would have put the tights over his face in order to obviously try and conceal his identity. A sharp-bladed instrument, which is a Stanley knife, so it's a cutting implement, but it can also be used as an offensive weapon. The cable ties were there for incapacitating people. The hacksaw blade, obviously, to go through metal, so any sort of locks, anything metal, could be a padlock, something like that, and also small torch, illumination. So here you've got a perfect little burgling kit.
A rural copper's hunch about a dodgy vehicle has uncovered a dangerous crook who clearly wasn't visiting his patch to enjoy the scenery.
So as well as the burgling kit, we've got the stolen car, we've got it on false plates, we've got the sawn-off shotgun, we've got the ammunition. He's just got everything in order to commit crime.
Neil's convinced that the suspect has been doing exactly that. But now he needs to find the victims. He's certain he's behind burglaries and other crimes committed in the area. But before Neil starts to investigate, the suspect makes an astonishing request.
The sergeant who was booking him in actually approached me and said, I don't believe this. I said, what? He said, well, he's just asked me, can he have a few sheets of A4 paper and a pen? Because he wants to write down every crime he's committed. And I said, happy days. I said, get him as much as he wants.
It's a huge moment for the investigation. Neil can't wait to hear what this criminal with a conscience has to tell him. And what he's about to discover will transform this local case into a major national investigation.
He's busy writing away reams, sheets and sheets of A4 paper, of crimes that he committed up and down the country. He'd gone off the rails, sadly. He was from a good family. He just wanted to get everything out of the way and start afresh.
He's certainly got plenty to get off his chest.
Cumbria, Merseyside, Manchester, Shropshire and Cheshire. This man is in custody. He's admitting all these offences in these areas. There was a lot of offences. I would estimate up to 100 crimes. 100 crimes that he admitted to.
It's an incredible confession list by a one-man national crime wave. He's remanded in custody. And Neil can't wait to share the extraordinary news with police forces across the country.
So you send out to the chief constable of those forces, this man is in custody within the Lancashire Constabulary. He's admitting all these offences in these areas. Can you please check and come back to us? Then you get the phone calls then. The phone is red hot. He wasn't a wanted man, because a lot of them, they didn't know he was responsible for committing those offences. So, the officers were elated, obviously, because I was able to give them the areas that I knew. Sometimes I was able to give them an address.
Opportunities like this to crack unsolved crimes don't come along often. And soon, police forces are queuing up to speak to the suspect.
Police officers from different force areas have come and interviewed him. The other forces didn't have any evidence to connect him to the crimes, so they'd no fingerprint evidence. But he was quite happy to talk, and he was quite happy to admit everything that he'd done.
Incredibly, they now have the man behind countless burglaries and thefts across the country. But there's still one crime that needs solving. How did such a dangerous criminal get his hands on a shotgun? Neil runs the serial number through the national computer.
The firearm that we recovered, it was stolen from a burglary in Shropshire. The detectives coming up from Shropshire were really delighted that they hadn't a clue who committed it. It was examined, it was capable of being fired, he could intimidate anybody, and he could have used it on anybody.
The man is charged with intent to end life, endangering an officer's life, and a string of burglaries. He pleads guilty and is sentenced to 9 years in prison.
This man was a professional burglar, but without a doubt. He knew what he was doing. He had everything to commit those offences. So to actually take him off the streets and put him away in prison for 9 years is a fantastic result.
What began as a minor crime that could have had major consequences became the biggest case of both Neil and John's careers. It's the end of the road for a prolific criminal who hadn't banked on coming up against a copper prepared to protect his patch at all costs.
Get him off the streets, get him locked up. But there was also a great deal of pride in what I'd just done. I'd locked up an armed blagger on my patch, and that really did give me a lot of satisfaction.
Our second case today starts as a routine check on a man acting suspiciously and exposes a trail of evidence left by a cold-blooded killer. During an illustrious career spanning over three decades, Detective Sergeant Ron Turnbull knew to always answer his phone.
When the phone call came in to us to say, we think we have another murder, then you just drop everything you're doing, put it to one side, get to that scene to evaluate it so that you don't lose the vital evidence that is there within the first 24 hours or so.
Ron was part of an elite group of forensic detectives who were the first to be called to major crime scenes.
What drove us on was more desire to find the perpetrators and get them out of the streets of London. The best part of the job, undeniably, was the fact that you were involved in these major inquiries to be able to find the golden hour, the golden nugget of evidence that ultimately brought that person or persons to court was just phenomenal.
But not all big crimes appear that way at first. This one case started with a very run-of-the-mill call-out to a high-rise estate in South London.
This investigation really got started when a sergeant and some young training PCs were called to a suspicious individual.
The man is accused of shoplifting in a supermarket next to the tower blocks. And he isn't playing ball with the police.
He didn't really respond to the questions by the sergeant. So they started making inquiries. One of the officers was able to ascertain from somebody who lived in the block that this individual had a squat on the 10th floor.
The sergeant decides to take a closer look inside the squat where the man lives.
When they went in there, they could see that there was all sorts of property and items and artifacts lying around. Credit cards and checkbooks relating to different names. And it became obvious that this was more than just a simple stop in the street.
The man is arrested and his squat sealed off. Ron starts to search for forensic evidence. And it's not long before the case takes a major turn.
But in a plastic shopping bag, there was a bloodstained hammer. There were two pairs of rubber gloves. One had a finger missing, which was unusual.
This is no longer a case of shoplifting, but something much bigger.
You know, the fact that I was looking at a bloodstained hammer, which is broken, which means it, you know, the only way it could be broken is that such force was being used when it became damaged.
Ron decides to widen the search for evidence. His gut instinct is they don't need to look far.
I had 6 weeks prior to that, in that same block, dealt with the murder of a 52-year-old woman. So my mind was directed at this evidence. Was it related to that murder?
The killer is still at large. With all his years of experience, Ron knows when something is more than just coincidence. And what he discovered in the flat just a few floors above is still weighing on his mind.
The female victim had failed to turn up for work. The company that she worked for were concerned. They couldn't get an answer to her phone. So Uniform officers were asked to make inquiries.
When they forced access to her flat, the missing persons case became a murder inquiry.
What I'm looking at is a photograph of the front door, which is where the female victim was found. The second photograph shows me that the view the officers had when they looked through the letterbox. They could see disarray in the hallway, and they could see what looked like shopping in a bag which was all over the place. So they forced an entry, and they found the dead body of a 52-year-old woman.
Her killer is still on the loose, and police are under huge pressure to crack the case. Ron's hunch is the suspect's squat holds the key. And he knows evidence is often to be found in the most unlikely of places.
Very few people look up when they're in a wardrobe. You look down and sideways or forward. But up above my head, basically up here, there were a number of checkbooks and credit cards. And when I subsequently removed them, some of those referred to a number of individuals, including the lady's address of 6 weeks hence. And that, for me, made that we now have a major suspect in her murder. There had to be a link.
Police now have enough evidence to put to the suspect. He's taken from his police cell to be questioned.
Throughout, he denied all knowledge. He said he'd found the bag in question containing the hammer and the gloves that morning. And he'd seen the credit cards and the checkbooks, and he was going to keep them anyway because he's a petty criminal.
What's more, he has an alibi.
When the girlfriend alibied him at initial stages by saying that he had been with her all that weekend of the murder.
It's a major blow and only adds to the mounting pressure on Ron to solve the case. He continues to examine the squat. There's one item in particular that really catches his eye.
Extraordinarily, there was also a letterbox, an exterior letterbox, bearing the number 77. The finding of the letterbox was unusual, to say the least. I've never seen that before or since. Was it a trophy? We didn't know.
But where has it come from? Ron's instinct is that there's another crime scene. They need to find it, and fast.
So I got in touch with the investigating officers of the previous murder, asking the officers to go and knock on the door of all the 77s in the block surrounding the one I was working in.
It's a clever idea from a seasoned detective. Ron knows when to trust a hunch. And it's not long before officers find the flat they're looking for.
I'm looking at a photograph, and I can see the exterior of that number 77, minus the letterbox, which was discovered in the squatters. And again, through that letterbox, officers were able to see that there was some disarray on the floor, and that led them to force entry.
What they find inside is about to blow the whole investigation wide open.
We were now possibly looking at a serial killer.
Our first two cases have involved dangerous criminals, but our next suspect is putting others at risk in a very different way. Could a small insurance claim inadvertently expose a much bigger fraud? For retired Detective Constable Mick Curtis, it's a fairly mundane Monday morning.
I was in the office at Worthing, just doing some paperwork, which all detectives would be doing.
But a query from another officer is about to put an end to Mick's routine duties.
He was dealing with a victim who had had a motorcycle crash, and he had no response from the insurance company, either by phone or letter, regarding his claim. He said it's a company called Just Bike Insurance.
Chasing insurance companies wouldn't usually be a police matter, but something about the situation just doesn't sit right with Mick.
He would have expected a reply from the insurance company, at the very least, but he couldn't even get through to the company, which seems strange. Straight away, you're starting to think, as a police officer, something's not right, I need to find out more. What was going on?
Some more digging reveals the man had seen an advert in a motorcycle magazine. He paid for his insurance by check and posted it to an address in the local area.
The address wasn't a business type address. It was definitely a residential address.
Mick's suspicions are heightened. Why would an insurance company be operating out of a suburban residential street?
I then made contact with the insurance bureau, see what they could tell me, because they should be registered with them. And we also contacted Company's House to see if we could find any details about Just Bike Insurance. And neither had any record of them as a registered company or a registered insurance company. So started to raise a little bit of a worry in my mind that this Just Bikes was not genuine.
What started out as a minor accident claim has potentially turned into something much bigger. Mick quickly organises a search warrant for the house.
The first thing that struck me were the expensive electrical goods that were inside the house, which weren't in keeping with that property.
Something isn't adding up. Where is the owner getting the money to pay for all the valuable items?
I found some insurance certificates, which were blanks and headed Just Bike. I found some envelopes that had been addressed to Just Bike, in which were application forms and checks for payment from various individuals. Also, I found the insurance certificate for the suspect's own vehicle with his name and details on it. So everything that I'm seeing is really making me think that there is something going on and that it's in the lines of an insurance fraud. I just needed more evidence.
If Mick's instinct is right, hundreds of unsuspecting motorcyclists could be riding around thinking they're insured when they're not, meaning they won't have protection if they have an accident. And when Mick compares the suspect's own insurance document from a well-known respected provider with the Just Bike policy, he makes a significant discovery.
This one has just got the Just Bike logo on the top, but actually, when you read through it, all the wording and all the terminology were identical from one form to the next across all the pages. And the suspect has just inserted the logo on each page.
It looks like the Just Bike policy has been copied from a genuine document, making it seem perfectly believable. And that's not all Mick's found.
Also in the house, we found checkbooks similar to this, which was a business account in the name of Just Bikes. This supported the fact that a business in the name of Just Bikes was operating from that address. Having now looked at all these documents, I was now confident there was a fraud.
But Mick has got no idea about the scale of the fraud. How many victims are currently riding around without valid insurance? He sends the seized documents to the lab for fingerprint analysis and immediately brings the homeowner in for questioning.
We interviewed the suspect with his solicitor, but on the advice of his solicitor, he went no comment to every question we put to him.
It's a frustrating blow for Mick. He needs to dig deeper into the suspect's finances.
I had obtained an order for the bank by now and identified the amount of funds, which were upwards of about £50,000, going through this business account.
But the money doesn't stay in the account for long. Cash withdrawals are being made frequently, making the money almost impossible to trace. Mick knows he's onto something big, but he's struggling to prove it. Then, a breakthrough. He finds a second property connected to the suspect.
This is where we found a box containing about £1,000 in cash. And I then found behind a radiator an envelope in which was around about £10,000. It'd be the most money I've ever had my hands on.
Mick also finds some building society accounts in the names of the suspects' children, with a staggering £30,000 in them. The sheer scale of the crime is becoming apparent. There could be hundreds of victims.
We were drawing together our jigsaw, and the jigsaw pieces were all fitting together nicely. We had money going into the business account, coming out of the business account, and now we had a substantial amount of cash and deposits into building society accounts. So we're now in a position where, evidentially, we had a really strong case.
The evidence continues to mount. The results are back from the lab, and they get a fingerprint match on the fraudulent documents.
We now had something to tie him to the blank certificates, the received cheques for Just Bike and the envelopes.
The offender has stolen a huge £50,000 in just 6 short weeks. Around 580 unsuspecting motorcyclists have given him their money. He pleads guilty to obtaining property by deception.
The judge sentenced him to 5 years imprisonment and an order for all of the monies that we had recovered to be repaid to the various policy holders that we had been able to identify. And I felt that we had actually got a result for the victims. This had all started because a man had dropped his motorcycle on the road by accident, caused some damage and tried to claim on his insurance. There were a lot of other people, over 500 people, still out and about on motorbikes, believing they were insured and they weren't. It started out to be quite a simple case, but it ended up being something much bigger.
There's one more case to close today. In London, a routine search of a high-rise squat has now spiraled into a murder investigation. Forensic officer Ron Turnbull is convinced the suspect in custody is the killer. And what's more, there could be other victims.
This is the landing on the floor. I think it's the 10th floor. This is number 77. What I'm looking at is the front door of where the front exterior part of the letterbox was missing.
The missing letterbox matches the one found in the suspect's squat, but there's no sign of the flat's owner.
They could see, looking through the letterbox, that it was ransacked and things were obviously stolen. You could see there was bank books and so forth on the floor. And when they went in into the bedroom, they found a dead body of a male who had been bludgeoned to death.
It's a long way from the first call about a suspected shoplifter. This is now a double murder investigation. Ron needs more evidence linking their suspect to the scene.
I had found in the squat a checkbook and credit cards bearing the name of the victim in this occasion. When we see that they have been dated and signed sort of the days before I found them, this takes it to another step. This is somebody who has probably just murdered someone and is quite mindless of their situation and are practicing to try and get into his bank account and get money from his cash point.
It's further evidence against a cold-blooded killer. But there's still one more missing piece of the jigsaw. And he's convinced the bag found inside the squat holds the key.
Having seen the blood-stained hammer in this little bag, rubber gloves obviously to protect his fingerprints from being found, but one of them had a tip missing.
There's no sign of it at the first murder scene. But as investigators scour the second victim's flat for clues, they make a huge breakthrough.
The tip of a similar glove was found near to his body, and that was mechanically linked by the scientist subsequently. So this is another step in the the process of drawing that individual into that crime scene.
It's a big one too. Ron knows the suspect's been inside the man's flat, but how did he get in there?
Unfortunately, they had no CCTV. The front door was secure. In fact, there was a grid outside and a metal grid. So, you know, perplexingly, is this the mode of entry?
Just like the first murder scene, there's no sign of forced entry. And it's left Ron baffled. Aware that so far the focus has been on inside the flats, he starts to think outside the box.
The shoe mark on the balcony alerted us to the fact that this could have been a point of entry. And there were also shoe mark impressions in a kitchen which looked onto the balcony. So now we had a situation where we knew that we had a climber, that someone who was able, by whatever means, to get in the balcony, get in the window, and perpetrate the burglary, and in this case, the murder.
Incredibly, the burglar has been accessing the high-rise flats by climbing down the outside from the roof. It's a brazen crime. Ron's never come across anything like it.
How he was able to do that is mind-blowing, extremely dangerous. Given that he did it during the hours of darkness, he must have been fearless to do that.
But he did, and he made it his specialization.
But he's also left his mark. And Ron thinks he's found the shoes that made it.
In my search, I found a pair of trainers that had quite distinct sole and pattern. They were fairly new. And I took a Polaroid of the sole, this trainer, and put that sealed inside a see-through evidence bag.
Ron's tireless search for clues has reached a critical moment. Are the trainers a match for the footprints found in the second victim's flat?
There is now the ascertained lift, as it's called by the scientists, from the trainer that we recovered in squat being overlaid on an acetate lift taken from the house of the second victim, the male. You can read the make of the trainer, there are certain points indicated that are absolutely identical to one another. And as the overlay is lifted and replaced, the two marks basically become one, which means that that shoe caused that mark in that location.
Ron secured a major forensic breakthrough that ties the suspect to the second victim and the murder scene.
That's the golden hour of evidence obtainment at the initial stages. If you miss that, then you miss the opportunity to get that evidence in at the old Bailey subsequently.
But has the suspect killed before? They find no forensic evidence at the first victim's flat linking him to her murder. So could the stolen cards hold the key?
With regards to the female victim I had dealt with earlier, the inquiries found out that her credit card had been used locally. And in all, I think £900 had been extracted. So unfortunately, they had no CCTV, so they couldn't identify the user.
If the suspect's not charged soon, the fear is he could be released to kill again. So, officers decide to revisit his girlfriend to double-check her statement.
She then withdrew the alibi and said that she was frightened of him. He was a violent individual. She knew he had committed certain burglaries. But on the weekend that the female had been murdered in that block, he had an errand to do. He left the premises and came back several hours later. He brought back a large sum of money, which he owed her.
His alibi has fallen apart, and her incredible revelations don't end there.
So they mentioned the hammer, and she said that she had loaned him a hammer of her own so he could do some DIY. Subsequently, she went to the laboratory where that hammer was still undergoing scientific process, and she said, "That's the hammer."
Not only can Ron place the suspect at the scene, he's got the murder weapon too.
That was icing on the cake for us. You know, we're going to the old Billy.
Ron's dogged determination to crack the case has paid off. he's exposed a violent criminal who's now charged with murder. Plus, numerous burglaries in his favourite hunting ground.
I think there were 7 or 8 tower blocks he could happily steal from these locations. And the credit cards and checkbooks that we found were ready to be used by him for his criminal endeavours. And he found a way that he could continue his stealing ways by monopolising on climbing and descending from the balconies.
There was an awful lot of opportunities for him to continue stealing.
And also to commit violence.
2 of them were aggravated burglaries, where he actually woke up. On one occasion, got a senior citizen and attacked him with a hammer. So if you waken up when he's burgling, you will get bludgeoned. And if you die, well, that's what happens in his mind. He's still going to go away and play with your credit cards.
But the suspect won't face trial for the murder of the first female victim.
The CPS felt there was insufficient direct forensic evidence, so they would not proceed on the indictment. That, would, from our point of view, is frustrating.
Ahead of the trial, Ron knows they need to focus on the strong evidence they do have and show the jury the unique way the man in the dock committed his crimes.
It was decided that we could display how easy it was for someone to actually go on the roof of these high-rise blocks and climb down. So a specialist firearm unit at Scotland Yard volunteered to assist us, and they were videoed doing exactly that. They came out of the top of one of the blocks, and albeit they were wearing safety lines, etc., but it was seen that they were, without too much difficulty, able to climb down and then, of course, climb into the window and then do the opposite and climb back up again. It was seen that this could be easily done if someone had a head for heights and was fit enough and strong enough and fearless enough to do so.
It's an astonishing crime. And without this detailed detective work that went through every element of the way he operated, the accused would have got away with it. But he didn't. And after a trial at the Old Bailey, he was convicted of murder and 12 burglary charges.
We did have a celebration, and the boss put on a couple of bottles of fizz, you know, and a pork pie or 3, so, you know.
A stop in the street by local bobbies has led to a violent killer serving a life sentence.
I'm immensely proud. We obtained the evidence that eventually put a very dangerous individual off the streets of London and gave some grievance to the victims, which is in itself enough.
An ordinary shift for a police officer.
It started out as nothing.
It was innocuous. It was a little crime.
Can quickly take an extraordinary turn.
A simple traffic stop went stratospheric within 2 minutes.
Speed UK, 70 miles an hour.
He's outside the petrol station fighting with another man.
A routine case.
You can start off with something and it can turn into something completely different.
Taser, taser! I'm here from you!
Can suddenly spiral into a serious incident.
Then it switched. He locked the door. She knew that something was very, very wrong here.
Stand by, I think we're going to have a decamp. One got out with a baseball bat. There's a ton of cannabis in the car.
They were literally on a rampage.
Sometimes the most minor crimes.
I was looking for a stolen quad bike. Found a lot more.
Can crack major cases.
We were now possibly looking at a serial killer.
Today on Big Little Crimes, a routine call out.
This looks like it's a tragic accident.
Takes a sinister turn.
This was a cold, calculated murder, and probably one of the worst murders I've dealt with.
A dodgy gambler reveals links to major organised crime.
We were dealing with something a lot bigger here,
and this was just the tip of the iceberg.
But first, a regular check on a speeding motorbike takes an extraordinary twist when police give chase.
It's a left, left, left. Come here now! On your front, on the floor, hands behind your back. Yeah, it is now failing to stop, catching road in towards town.
After nearly two decades catching criminals, Detective Constable Dave Bastuba thinks he's seen it all.
You are going to deal with things. You are going to see things. You are going to be exposed to things that you might not have seen in your previous life.
But sometimes, even he gets caught by surprise. That's what happened with one routine case, which got off to a very fast start.
An officer was on patrol in uniform in a marked vehicle. And at that time, the officer saw a motorcycle come the opposite direction in Northampton town centre towards him. And he thought that motorcycle was going quite quick for being within the town centre area. So that alerted his suspicion.
In the UK, speeding offences are the most common vehicle crime the police have to deal with. The officer takes the usual action of following the motorbike to see what it's up to. The rider picks up pace, and the officer knows what to do next.
He took the number plate, those digital letters, and he put them from a police national computer to establish what kind of vehicle it should be, who the owner is, or does it have insurance.
It's a standard number plate check. But the response is far from routine.
It came back to a Mazda vehicle, but it was clearly a motorcycle. So at this point now, the officer's suspicion is raised quite a lot. So as the officer ignited the blue lights and requested for that motorcycle to pull over, the motorcycle decided to speed up through the town centre.
The chase is on, but the motorcycle refuses to stop. He runs a red light. What's he got to hide?
But at this point, he did not know why a motorcycle had a Mazda registration plate or why this motorcycle failed to stop for a police officer.
Yeah, look, the vehicle up here is in the distance, still speed, 80, going in towards Northampton Ketchum Road. Somebody's heavy braking. Yeah, it is now failing to stop, Ketchum Road in towards town. Speed 80, road conditions are wet, super driver, super vehicle. Which channel do you want me to remain on? Now, Ketchum Road into town, approaching Morrison's now. Here's a left, 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 Northwood Road. It's going to go onto a footpath, I can't follow. Somewhere's crash, crash, he's off and running.
The suspect abandons the motorbike and flees on foot.
Running, footpath, end of Northwood Road. I think he's turning up towards Broadmead Avenue. Got right through a gate. Come here now! He's following us to the flats. Hands behind your back. Hands behind your back. On your front. On your front, on the floor.
Complying.
On your front, on the floor, hands behind your back. Over.
Later, the chase isn't over. It's about to take a major turn.
Go on the floor.
Not doing it.
On the floor. Get on the floor! Get on the floor! Yeah, just lamp me one. We're now running back up. Amongst the footpath.
Our next case today begins on the tail of a suspicious gambler and follows a trail of cash linked to a major crime network. Casinos, a world of wealth, glamour, and high stakes. But where there's money, there are criminals trying to get their hands on it. And in some cases, they win big. Cracking this kind of intricate financial crime is what DS Trevor Dickey lives for.
I could see that technology-enabled crime was becoming something new. So for me, that was, you know, an opportunity to really specialise in something very, very different.
He spent years in the National High-Tech Crime Unit investigating cyber criminals. It was this expertise that helped him to crack one highly sophisticated case. And it all starts when a woman walks into a central London casino.
The lady just appeared to be like any other person attending the casino, generally well turned out, to give that air of, you know, success, that she had money.
Although she looks the part, casino security quickly noticed something out of the ordinary.
The lady concerned came into the casino, cashed out £1,000 of chips using a bank card. She then moved from table to table, but didn't appear to be really gambling.
Security do a trawl of CCTV footage and spot the woman doing the same thing time and time again.
When they started to look at her previous visits, they became suspicious because the names and the cards were changing. And so that was a real red flag for them.
She's using dozens of different bank cards, all in different names. Something doesn't add up. When the casino alerts police, the case is passed on to Trevor's cyber team. His first instinct is that he already knows what she's up to.
Because we'd had a number of other investigations that centered around, you know, identity theft, online fraud, we became suspicious that she was lower level type fraud, so where she has access to the card, low values initially, but high volume.
Identity fraud is one of the fastest growing crimes. More than 250,000 cases are reported to police each year.
That activity can have the benefit of several thousands of pounds of fraud in one person's hands.
Trevor heads to the casino in search of solid evidence to back up his suspicions.
The decision was made to go back to the casino and work with the security staff, revisit some of the CCTV and establish, was there a timeline, a pattern of when she would attend?
Trevor believes the woman could be using the casino to draw out money from different accounts and turn it into cash. But where is the money coming from? He notices the cards are all from the same bank.
Criminals are very, very quick at picking up on opportunities. What we did notice was that it was consistently one bank, because one moving money from one account to another within the same bank probably doesn't have as many checks as if you're moving it to a different bank.
Trevor's hunch is that there's a good reason why this high street bank has been chosen.
This particular bank, from a business perspective, was also being very proactive in getting people from within Europe who were coming to work in the UK to really just make it easier for them to be able to open accounts.
It's the first clue that this little crime might be something much bigger. Trevor needs to figure out how the woman's getting her hands on the money, and if she's part of a larger criminal network.
We made a sort of a tactical decision that we would conduct proactive surveillance at the casino to see if we could then, one, follow her activity in the casino to try and get a better idea of what she was doing, but also to track her movements once she had left the casino to establish connections to any other people. You know, is there somebody waiting for her?
Trevor and his team set up at the casino and watch the woman's every move.
Casinos do have good CCTV coverage, so you're able to follow somebody's movements pretty well just from the CCTV in a control room without actually having to have officers, you know, in the casino pretending, because there is always the risk that, you know, their activity draws the attention.
He observes her taking out £1,000 each night, having a little flutter, and then cashing in most of the chips.
I think the purpose of her sort of drawing to about £1,000 on the card is because that's under the threshold of, for the banks, particularly drawing the attention.
But why go to so much trouble when she could just use a cash machine?
A lot of cards would have a maximum spend for the day. And so it's about timing, you know, when you use that card to be able to get the benefit of that maximum withdrawal at the time.
Cash machines have a standard withdrawal limit of £300. But she's able to get out more than that to buy chips at the casino. Trevor suspects she's involved in a bigger fraud network, and he needs her to lead him to the other players. The surveillance team takes the risky decision to follow her out of the casino. But if they're spotted, officers could blow their cover and the entire case. They carefully follow her to a house where she meets a man.
We conducted further surveillance on the premises because, again, we wanted to build up a picture of people, you know, coming and going to see, was there more to it, you know, really what her involvement was.
Trevor's team spend days staking out the property. They realize the suspect lives there with the mystery man. But what's their relationship? And is he even connected to this crime? Meanwhile, other officers are examining the woman's bank accounts. And they found something that just doesn't add up.
There was a very high frequency of money transfers coming into particularly the accounts that she had used, the one that she controlled mainly. It started to give us names of other people that we thought, OK, this is perhaps a bigger network.
Finding these other names in the suspect's account is a huge leap forward. It's the first piece of solid evidence that she's not working alone.
What we started to establish was that a lot of these accounts were being opened with fake identities or false passports. We started to see the same individual's photograph.
This is now much more than a woman behaving unusually at a London casino. What Trevor notices next transforms the investigation far beyond the capital.
And one of the patterns we saw in relation to the identity documents, i.e. the passports, is that they were from a variation of countries, but predominantly from, you know, Eastern Europe.
This is fraud on a massive scale, with links to global organised crime.
Actually, we've got a lot more going on here. We knew that they were involved in far bigger criminality, and the potential harm of what they were doing is way more, you know, significant.
Later, as the true scale of this major case unfolds...
This woman was running a money laundering network.
The net closes in on an international criminal gang.
She controlled a significant number of money mules.
Up to now, our cases have involved officers trying to keep the key suspect clearly in their sights. But in our next story, the trail is murkier and more deadly. Detective Chief Inspector Steve Whittaker always had to be at the top of his game.
I was a senior investigating officer in charge of homicides, who dealt with everything really from manslaughter, murder, kidnaps, all the serious high-end crime that was involved in it. Wanted people to be sent to prison who deserved to be sent to prison.
That dogged determination proved crucial in one of the biggest cases of Steve's career. And it all began one very ordinary match day weekend.
There was a big football match in Sheffield between Sheffield United and Manchester City.
This was an FA Cup fifth round game.
There's a report of a car accident near Sheffield United's football stadium, Bramall Lane.
You've got a lot of traffic, be that foot traffic, vehicle traffic, and you've got quite a lot of police officers in that area and lots of members of public all attending a game.
The roads are packed, so the incident isn't all that surprising.
Police would have got to that first, they would have wondered what was happening, and probably at first thinking, well, this looks like it's a tragic accident.
It's a routine call-out. Police don't suspect a crime, but they soon make a shocking discovery.
I think the best way to describe it was quite chaotic. There was a vehicle, there was nobody in it, which is unusual, and there was a person dead, actually trapped under the front wheels of that vehicle. So quite an horrific sight for officers to attend. Is it an accident? It could be. We can't discount that. Has a person decided to kill themselves by jumping out into the road and they want to get run over, they want to end their life? You can't discount that. Or is there something actually more sinister afoot?
Police secure the potential crime scene. And it isn't long before they discover a set of tyre marks. They search the abandoned car for clues.
There's some real sinister items found within the car, which was a knife, very similar to this. A bandana used to disguise your face, and a discarded, left by mistake, mobile phone. There was also two axes, a balaclava, and some petrol. Things were unraveling quite quickly.
What started as an ordinary traffic accident has taken an extraordinary turn.
People, witnesses came forward and said that there was a man being attacked with baseball bats and hammers, with people dressed in balaclavas and their faces covered. So it became quite sinister.
A woman was also seen getting out of the car and running away laughing. This is now a murder investigation, and Steve's leading the hunt for the killers.
I got a phone call on the Sunday evening. I was told it's going to be a long day tomorrow.
The victim is named as 30-year-old Nawajid Khan. The post-mortem reveals he had a devastating head injury.
It was quite clear we needed to find out who was driving that vehicle, why he's dead, who's responsible, and joining all the dots up, really.
Step one, who is the owner of the car? And what Steve finds next is about to transform the whole investigation. The victim's wife, Faria Khan, bought the car using a false name just a day before her husband's death.
Faria Khan became a suspect, I think, quite quickly. Is that, you know, attempts were made to notify her, as we would expect. You know, you're going to notify the next of kin that a person's been killed or died in a road traffic accident or been murdered. She made herself unavailable. Her family members were told she'd not come home that evening. And secondly, there's a person seen running away, fitting her description, Asian female. And certainly some work colleagues of the victim came forward and said things weren't too rosy at home, to say the least. So everything's ramping up to go towards, actually, there's something not right here.
Steve's gut instinct tells him Faria is the key to this case.
By Monday afternoon, I'd gone out with some of the team and we'd set up waiting for her to return home. And when she returned home, she was arrested on suspicion of murder.
But now the real pressure. With only 24 hours to question Faria, Steve needs to gain enough evidence or she'll be released without charge.
So she was interviewed and decided to make no comment to quite a few questions put to her. Well, you can draw your own conclusions from why somebody would make no comment.
The clock's ticking. Steve needs more evidence.
We found a mobile phone in the back of that car, so we sent that off to be examined to look at who you were texting on that phone, incoming and outgoing phone calls, and where that phone had been through interrogation, through masts, etc., where that phone had been prior to the murder. It was quite clear then that we had found out there was somebody else cleaning that car and we'd got somebody else's name. That mobile phone turned out to be a mobile phone of a very close friend of Faria Khan's.
The phone belongs to her best friend, Neelam Kauza. Steve immediately brings her in for interview.
Neelam Kauza told us a great deal, really. I've never been in trouble with the police before, so I think down to her naivety and down to thinking, actually, I can push this away from myself. She told us that she was friends with Faria Khan. Faria Khan had befriended her. Faria Khan, she said, was with a guy that had not got very Western ideas. Faria Khan was really Westernised.
But what she reveals next is about to transform the investigation.
Faria Khan had started seeing somebody and she wanted him out of the way. And that out of the way meant she wanted him dead.
Later, Steve's determination to crack the case uncovers the truth about the victim's brutal murder.
He was getting away. He was managing to fight his way. And she, I think, just lost the plot and decided to kill him.
Back on the tail of a speeding motorcyclist, an everyday traffic stop is fast becoming one to remember.
Somebody's crash, he's off and running. Running, footpath, end of Northwood Road. I think he's going up towards Broadmead Avenue.
A dramatic chase is now continuing on foot.
Got right through a gate. Come here now! Come on, let's go off the flats. Hands behind your back. Hands behind your back. On your front. On your front, on the floor.
Complying.
The officers finally catch up with the suspect, but need to handcuff him and find out who he is.
What's your name? What's your name?
White.
Huh?
White.
I'm asking your name.
Get my handcuffs off.
Right. You going in handcuffs?
Get the handcuffs off. Can you get the handcuffs off, please?
Go on the floor.
I'm not doing it.
On the floor. Get on the floor! Get on the floor! Yeah, just lamp me one. We're now running back up onto the footpath. That's all brought me down here, Northwood Road. He's running still at the footpath.
The officer desperately needs backup to help catch him. A police dog handler is in the area and ready to follow the scent.
It's going to have been coming out of there. He's either gone that way or that way.
There's no sign of him. Suddenly, they spot the suspect.
By this time, the male had discarded his jacket. And as he turned around, he recognised the male.
It's the familiar face of a local serial burglar. A minor number plate check has led police to a well-known thief. But why was he so keen to get away this time? While the man is arrested and taken back to the station, the police need to track down the jacket he ditched during the chase. The sniffer dog sets to work.
The orange jacket was recovered, and inside them was a glass hammer. Now, glass hammer, we have them in our police cars as well. You can break car windows with them. They are quite strong, and they have a metal point. So we found that within there, and I believe there were some gloves as well.
The police know this man is a prolific burglar, and the hammer and gloves could be evidence that he's out committing more crime. They go back to the motorbike he abandoned during the chase and find more crucial evidence. Some medication with the burglar's name and date of birth on it. This is the breakthrough they needed. It confirms the rider's identity and links him to the motorbike and the jacket. The case against him is getting stronger and stronger. But who does the bike belong to?
When the officer checked the engine number for their motorcycle, they established that it had been stolen a month earlier in a burglary in Kettering.
From speeding to bike theft to burglary. And Dave knows all about that case. He spent the last few weeks trying to crack it.
Police received a phone call that a person had come home from work and that he had a motorcycle locked up to the lamppost outside his address, but somebody had broken through his front door and taken the key for their motorcycle and had ridden it off.
Now it's case closed. The suspect was caught on CCTV stealing the motorbike, and it's the same guy they have in custody.
I knew exactly who he was because I had dealt with him before. I mean, he was a prolific offender.
If only he'd stuck to the speed limit, he might not have been caught this time. The man is charged with burglary, driving offences, and assaulting a police officer during his arrest. He pleads guilty and is jailed for 2.5 years.
I was happy for the victim because at that time, when we found the motorcycle, we could obviously return that to the victim and also brings closure to him.
A motorcyclist in a hurry and a determined road traffic officer have led to a major criminal being put behind bars.
For me, I just knew that I had dealt with a burglar who was a risk and I had put him away, knowing that nobody else would have to be subject to his crimes anymore.
Back in London. A small case of a suspicious gambler has exposed a big money laundering network. A woman has been using different cards to buy thousands of pounds of chips at a casino before becoming a bit shy at the betting tables.
Her activity of, you know, drawing on the card, so effectively cashing perhaps say £1,000 worth of chips, was it a consistent pattern? She would then, you know, maybe have a small, I would call, flutter here and there, make it look like she's gambling, but she hadn't really, you know, spent anything.
DS Trevor Dickey and his team are now staking out the house where she lives with a man.
We strongly believe that the male and female were connected to each other, that they were most likely involved in a relationship.
They're still unable to identify the man and whether he's involved in the fraud too. But what they do discover are lots of transactions sent from fake accounts to the woman's accounts. She then uses her bank cards to buy chips in the casino, only to cash them in later in the evening. Trevor knows exactly how the money laundering gang work, but where is the money coming from?
If we can stop this at its early stage, we can prevent, you know, a lot more harm. It's a very challenging thing to do. We need to get to the bottom of this because we need to stop this happening.
The accounts set up with fake IDs have addresses linked to them. So Trevor puts each of the houses under surveillance.
We started to build up this intelligence picture of addresses sort of scattered throughout, you know, North London, South London, Southeast London.
The people who live there all have one thing in common. They're the same people, mainly Eastern European, who set up the fake bank accounts used to transfer cash to the main suspect.
She controlled a significant number of money mules. Money mule is really just a play on a drugs mule, somebody who moves money.
In North London, the surveillance team still have eyes on the female suspect and the mystery man. Trevor is about to make an astonishing discovery. A photo of the man is matched on the police database. He's Russian, and it's believed he has ties to bigger organized crime.
It was clear that this individual had been involved in this sort of activity for quite some time, and that the female at that same address was clearly his, you know, his partner in crime.
With the discovery that a criminal gang could be involved, Trevor decides it's time to act.
We put together a plan, what we call a day of action, where we're going to execute search warrants at multiple addresses.
In the early hours of the morning, the police take the fraudsters by surprise.
I remained in our command centre, coordinating those arrests and coordinate where to take those particular individuals to relevant police stations, to also make sure that there was no ability for them to come into contact with each other.
The man and woman are arrested, along with other members of the scam. Police find a treasure trove of dodgy paperwork, fake IDs, and large bundles of cash. This is a long way from one casino customer acting oddly. But how it all fits together is still unclear to Trevor, and no one will talk.
So after the first round of interviews, our subjects were released under investigation.
Again, bear in mind, these people are foreign nationals, probably new to our sort of system.
That then gave us a period of time to analyse the materials that we'd seized at the addresses, so to build up our evidential package.
Shockingly, the seized evidence shows the money going into the woman's accounts is from an online scamming scheme.
This is a money laundering operation, but it's connected to a technology-enabled crime, which was phishing.
Victims are sent an online phishing link claiming to be from a trusted organization, and which tricks them into providing their bank details, or worse, directly giving money. This money then goes into the fake accounts and is transferred to the woman who takes the cash out in casinos. The money is used to fund organized crime.
We certainly knew, as investigators, that there was a much bigger picture, and that this was really a global phenomenon, and they were just a small part of it. We were dealing with something a lot bigger here, a lot more, you know, criminality involved, and that perhaps this was just the tip of the iceberg.
The man with links to bigger organized crime seems to be the brains behind the money scams.
Our impression of him was that he was very much the technical expertise. He was actively involved in setting up phishing pages to lure people in to one voluntarily, you know, provide their bank accounts, but also for creating the recruitment pages to lure people in to be money mules.
Trevor and the team have taken down a criminal enterprise worth hundreds of thousands of pounds. The gang all plead guilty to money laundering.
Our subjects, you know, were sentenced to, you know, prison terms ranging from as little as 6 months to a maximum of 3 years.
The woman cashing out at the casino got a 3-year suspended prison sentence. What started with a small piece of intelligence about a lone gambler has led to the dismantling of a global money laundering network. There's one more case to close today, where a routine traffic call-out on a busy match day has spiralled into a murder investigation led by DCI Steve Whittaker.
This certainly wasn't a tragic accident. There's certainly something more sinister to this than met the eye.
The victim was attacked by a group of men before being run over by his wife, Faria. She's now in custody, accused of murder, along with her best friend, Neelam. But the hunt for the rest of the gang continues. While Faria still refuses to cooperate, Neelam reveals to Steve that Faria did recruit the men to attack her husband.
What she told us became quite sinister, really, that she had recruited some friends, and the intention that day was to give him a bit of a good hiding. She played that down. She thought they were just going to give him a bit of a smack to stay away from her.
Neelam denies they were hired to kill him. But when Steve examines messages on her phone, he finds a very different story.
It was quite clear through the phone that it was far more sinister than that. There was days and days and weeks of text messages between Faria's phone and Neelam Cowser's phone. And obviously we got Neelam Cowser's phones. There's a real sinister one that said, on the morning of the murder itself, we need to do it today, it's on.
The texts show that Faria offered the men money to kill her husband.
If it wasn't so serious, it'd be laughable, to a tune of £200. £200 to assist in killing her husband. I think if it's £200,000 or £200, you know, what price in a man's life, but £200 makes it the added insult for me that anybody would think that actually that's the price of a man's life.
The messages are the turning point Steve needs in this fast-moving case.
There was then some further evidence on there of Faria Khan saying it was quite clear that Faria Khan and some of the associates were actually watching the movements of Nawajid. He was being followed. So this wasn't a spur of the moment. This was a pre-planned attack, and a pre-planned attack that led to the death of Nawajid.
The text messages are not the only compelling evidence against the victim's wife.
We recovered a knife block from Faria Khan's house, and the knife block contained five knives with one knife missing, and that knife was in the car at the time.
What started as a report of an ordinary car accident is now a case of cold-blooded murder. And Steve is slowly piecing together what happened.
Nawajid was on his way to the takeaway where he worked, not realising his wife was planning to murder him that day. Unfortunately, he didn't make it.
Faria drove the group of men close to the takeaway, ready to attack and kidnap her husband.
The car pulled up. The four lads got out of the car and set about Nawajid Khan. And they set about him with baseball bats and hammers.
Faria watched from her car as the attack happened.
It was clear then that this was going wrong. He was getting away. He was managing to fight his way.
But he didn't escape, because his wife took matters into her own hands and brutally ran him over.
He, I think, just lost the plot and decided to kill him, and to kill him in front of lots of witnesses, lots of young children, lots of people that are travelling to a football match. I don't think she cared at that stage. I think she just lost her mind and decided, that's it, I'm going to do it, I've had enough. And she decided to kill him. This was a cold, calculated murder, and probably one of the worst murders I've dealt with.
Steve has enough evidence to charge Faria and her friend Neelam with murder.
Unfortunately, for the investigation, the job doesn't stop there. We've got other people to look at and other people to bring into custody.
Based on the text message evidence and witness statements from the scene, he's identified the men paid to carry out the attack. Now he needs to track them down.
We needed to find out where they lived. We needed to arrest them, and arrest them as quickly as we could, because the longer it went on, the more chance there was that we were going to be losing evidence.
The men are soon found and brought in for questioning. They admit to being there, but deny planning to kill the victim.
We're trying to distance themselves, saying it wasn't me. We were just going to give him a smack, not to kill him.
But thanks to witnesses who saw the attack on the victim and physical evidence found in the car, the men are charged with murder. Steve and his team prepare the case for trial.
If you're concerned as an officer in the case or a senior investigating officer, have you got enough to make a jury sure? And do they think beyond reasonable doubt that your case is watertight, that they can find them guilty? As a greedy police officer, you always want that. Bit more. And lo and behold, we did get a bit more.
Weeks later, out of nowhere, Steve gets a call from Doncaster Prison.
One of the men who was charged with the murder then went on remand. And whilst remanded in custody, he decided then to speak to his cellmate. He was in prison, cellmate he didn't know. And again, it just shows what a bit of a fantasy world that these people live in. He then decided to tell him everything about the case. The cellmate then, luckily for us, came forward and he spoke to us in the investigation and told us exactly what had been said. That yes, they had gone that day. The intention was to get him in the car and the intention was to murder him that day.
It's more strong evidence to put before a jury. The trial lasts 8 weeks. Finally, the defendants are found guilty.
Fareer Khan was sentenced to life imprisonment with a minimum of 20 years. Neelan Kauser, she got life imprisonment with a minimum of 14 years. And the men, two of them were found guilty of murder. They got life imprisonment with a minimum of 17 years each. And two of the other boys in the car were found guilty of lesser offences. And they received between 7 and 8 years imprisonment as well.
What looked to be an unusual road traffic accident turned out to be a brutal and premeditated murder.
She put all this together. She got people, recruited people and organised this. And this is a woman now who showed throughout the trial absolutely not one shred of remorse.
From an ordinary accident at a football match to a carefully planned killing.
She was a cold, calculating woman.